recording this session, and you will be getting the recorded session after the class. Fine, so the answer to the very simple question, what is selenium, is like this. Selenium is an automation testing tool, obviously, but it's not a single tool. It comprises of various things inside it. Okay, now what happens is that in Selenium you have got many tools. For example, when Selenium came up in the market 2 to 3 years back, there was something known as Selenium RC. Okay, not 2 to 3 years back, but a long time back. In 2007, I worked on it for the first time. So there was known as Selenium ID in 2007, and there was something known as Grid. Grid 2 was there. Sorry, Grid 1. Okay. Now this tool was made by ThoughtWorks. Initially, it was made for their own testing purpose. This tool basically works on Mozilla. ID as a tool only worked on Mozilla, but Selenium RC could work on multiple browsers such as Mozilla, Chrome, Firefox, then Safari. Okay, so all these Opera and all these browsers were supported. So if people had to work on multiple browsers, they used to use Selenium RC, otherwise they used to use ID. And what used to happen was, RC, to learn RC, people required a lot of technical expertise. Like they either had to know Java, C Sharp, or Ruby, or Python, Perl, PHP. So this was the initial scenario, that you had got RC, ID, and Grid. Grid helps you to execute your test cases parallelly under multiple test cases. Okay, so what happens is that in Grid, you have a central machine and you connect your machine, you call that central machine hub, and you connect multiple machines and you run your test cases parallelly. Okay, now this is the scenario which we had earlier, that is, we had Selenium RC, ID, and Grid 1. Now RC as a tool had lot of shortcomings. People had to use lot of JavaScript and all in it and extend it using user extensions. The API was small, right? And there used to be a server in it. We used to start and stop the server. So what these guys, ThoughtWorks and Google, did, they came up with a new tool, and this new tool is known as WebDriver. Okay, WebDriver also works in multiple browsers, like Mozilla is supported, Chrome is supported, IE is supported, Safari support has also come up recently. Plus, it also supports Android and iPhone. Now, this doesn't mean that it will actually automate your Android and iPhone applications. Okay? Selenium is a tool which works in browsers. This means that it will only automate your websites, that is, how your website is opening in Android or iPhone, it can test, but it cannot test a game or something in Android or iPhone. Okay, ID remains the same, and instead of Grid 1, Grid 2 has come up. Right, Grid 2 works with WebDriver, and again, WebDriver code can be written in any of the languages like Java, C Sharp, Ruby, Python, and all. You just need to learn one of the languages and you can write the code. Okay, so in this course we will be studying everything with Java language, because most 70% of the industry learns Selenium with Java. Okay, now meanwhile, if you have any questions on Selenium, please feel free to ask. You can just use the WebEx chat on the top, fine. You can actually use the participants tab. You can unmute yourself, you can ask a question, fine. So there are various ways in which you can communicate with me. If you have added me on Skype, you can also ask me a question in Skype, fine. Now the thing is, in this course, what you can expect in this course, because as I told you, Selenium is very vast. Like apart from these, we use TestNG, we use JUnit, we build frameworks and all everything. Okay. So the thing is, I cannot teach so much thing in so many things in online training, because if I start with the Java language, first of all, I need to start with the Java language and then teach all of these things. This course will not finish for 3 months. Okay, and if you ask me a question that how much Java is required, well, I would say, okay, fine, fair enough knowledge of Java is required, core Java is required. Many people are afraid of learning Java and they think that fine, I cannot learn Java because I'm not from a programming background or something like that. Well, if you think that you cannot learn, you'll never be able to learn it. I've seen many people with positive attitudes learning them, many people in QA. It's not a big deal, you just have to learn core Java, it's not advanced Java, you just have to learn core Java, that's it. And I'll be teaching that in the course as well. Fine. So in this course, I will be covering following topics. I'll be covering Java, I'll be covering frameworks like TestNG and JUnit, and I'll be covering WebDriver completely, how to test all the Ajax applications and all, everything in WebDriver you can think of, right, I'll be covering. And then I'll be covering frameworks such as data-driven, keyword, hybrid, page object model, I can talk about them. Fine. And that's what we are going to do in this course. Right. Now, if you have to learn something else, for example, how to do database testing with Selenium, flash testing with Selenium, or you have to learn about SVN, Maven and all. So, you know, I have this website. You must have seen my website, qtpselenium.com. Right. If you go to the Selenium section, this is the Selenium section, right? Now, the out here I have mentioned 40 modules, 40. Okay, and these 40 modules, they cover a lot of stuff. Right, what I will be doing is, I will be giving you a login ID wherein you will have access to videos on all these 40 modules. You will be given a login. Wherein when you log in into your account, you will have access to all these modules. You will have the watchtower buttons enabled. So that this access will be a permanent access, this will be forever, and this will actually help you out in the training. Right. So let's not waste the time. If you have any questions, you can feel free to ask me. Okay. What we'll do is we'll move forward and we'll start with the training. Right. The first thing which we'll start is Java language and a little bit of WebDriver as well. We will see in the first 5 classes, right? We'll study both of them. Now, the first thing which you need to learn is that how to install Eclipse on your system. I think everybody will be having Java on their machines. Fine. You just need to get Eclipse, right? So you go here to Google and just type download Eclipse. What is Eclipse? Eclipse is just like an editor for Java. For example, you have Turbo C to write the C, right? Similarly, out here you have got Eclipse. So you go here to Eclipse downloads section and you basically download this one, Eclipse IDE for Java EE developers. There is a specific reason for this I am telling you. Fine. And once you download Eclipse in your system, and like I have this, you extract it, you'll get a folder like this, Eclipse. Fine. Under this, you'll have eclipse.exe. When you run this exe file, Eclipse will start. If you have a 64-bit machine, okay, if you are having a 64-bit machine, please make sure that you have installed JDK. But sometimes Eclipse never works on 64-bit machines until or unless you know, don't download and install JDK. Just go here, Java SC downloads, and on this page you can download the JDK from here. Okay, so make sure that JDK is installed if you have a 64-bit machine. Right. Now once you start Eclipse, then when you run eclipse.exe, you see a window like this, and this window will come up. This is known as a workspace launcher. this practically tells you where you will be storing all your Java code when you are working with Selenium. Fine. I'll write that. I'll store my Java code in this location called October weekday. So this is the location where all my Java code will be stored in throughout the training for your batch October underscore weekday. So when you run Eclipse, hold on, launching. Many of you might find that you know all these things, right? But as you proceed by tomorrow, day after tomorrow, you'll realize that things are getting interesting, right? So I'm teaching in perspective of that person right now who is looking at Java for first time. So I'm just looking at teaching in that perspective. Well, I basically assume you know basics of programming, what a for loop is, what if statement is, and all everything. I'm presuming that, right? If you are not just zero in programming, right? So you can close the welcome screen out here, okay? And this is Eclipse. You can close the outline and you can close the task line, fine. Now, in Eclipse, in the central section over here, you write the code. Out here, you have a package explorer where you see all the Java files. And out here, you get the results. So here are the results. The coding is done here, and the Java files will be kept here. Okay? Why do we need Java? Why do we need Java? Just a minute. This guy is not able to join the training. Now, why do we need Java out here? Why do we need Java with Selenium? Why can't we use other languages? So questions like these, I will answer them. Fine. And how do we write test cases with Selenium? And also, all these questions will be answered as we proceed with the course. But first of all, we should concentrate on Java. This is the major mistake which people do while learning Selenium. I've been training people since 1 year now and working with Selenium over 5 years. But the major mistake which people do is that they don't learn Java. They just try to jump over to Selenium. I will write my test cases now in Selenium. It's not like that. It's a process. It's a step-by-step thing. If you don't know, learn Java, you'll not be able to learn Selenium at all. Okay, so I'll start with Java. I'll start with very basic concepts of Java. Fine. What I'll do is So I'll just create a new project. You create a new project in Eclipse by right-clicking in the white space and going to New Project option over here, or go to Other, and you will see Java. Expand this and you will see Java project. Click on next, enter the project name. See, I will enter the project name as day one. Next and finish. Click on finish. Right. Now, this is the project. It's got a source folder and a JRE system library inside it. Fine. The source folder will have all the Java code, and JRE system library is actually Java which was installed on your system. And this is actually Java which is installed in the system. If you right click on the project, you get properties of this project. Shortcut is Alt Enter. If you look at the properties, you will see that the project is actually under this location. If you copy this location and physically go to that particular location, you will see that the day one project is here, and under that there is a source folder and lot of other files and folders, out of which the source folder is visible in Eclipse. Fine, all these things are not visible, so they shouldn't be visible actually. So Eclipse only shows the source folder in which we keep the Java file. The dot project file is actually a project is actually a file which represents that this is a Eclipse project. If I delete this file, this project will not open in Eclipse. Okay, so this is about Eclipse creating a new project. Fine. Now in source folder, I'll create a new file. You right click on the source folder, right click, go to new and class. okay, select the class. I'll just name the class as sample underscore java, and I keep a checkbox here on public static void main. Fine. When I finish this, right, you have this program coming up. Okay, you just go to window preferences and go to general appearance colors. I'm just increasing the font so that everybody is able to see. I'll just increase the font. Fine. So this is your Java code. It starts like this: public class sample Java. This is the class. The name of the class should be same as name of the Java file. This is the first rule in Java. The name of the class should be same as name of the Java file. Okay. And inside it, this is the main function in which the control comes for the first time when you run the program. For example, in C, the control comes in the main function for the very first time when you run the program, right? Similarly, out here it comes. What is public? What is static? You will actually come to know about these as I start with the concept of object-oriented programming. Fine. So you will come to know about these things, right? Java is an object-oriented programming language. So many people have told me that I am not able to find good documentation on Selenium. The documentation on Selenium is very poor. There is very less information available on the internet. I get all these complaints by many people. Well, the thing is, it is not poor. The documentation is good. Only thing is, it is a little bit technical in nature. If you go to the site seleniumhq.org, this is the, hold on. Right. This is the Selenium website, seleniumhq.org. The first line says that Selenium automates browsers. It's the tool which can only automate browsers, not your thick clients, not the desktop applications, only your browsers. Fine. You go to the download section over here, and you will see that there's a link over here called JavaDocs. Language client version release. This is JavaDoc link. If you click on this JavaDoc link, you get this documentation. This is a very good documentation on Selenium. It's known as JavaDoc. But the thing is, it is technical in nature. You need to understand the concepts of object-oriented programming to actually understand this documentation. What are objects, what are interfaces, inheritance, and all encapsulation, abstraction. So all you need to know, you need to know all these things. That's why people, they actually fail to learn Selenium, because they don't go in a systematic way. They don't learn Java first. The complete documentation of Selenium is object-oriented. Now if I go back to my Java program over here, I'll be starting with the concepts of object-oriented programming today, and I'll tell you how objects are used in Selenium. Fine. So this is my class. Public, static, and all these keywords will be clear to you as I start with object-oriented programming. And this is the main function. The name of the class, it should be same as name of the file. If I give a name of the class different than the name of the file, immediately Eclipse will throw an error. If you move your mouse over the error, in Eclipse, whenever you get an error, you get the red sign. And if you move your mouse over this red line, you will actually see two options to fix this error. Either rename the Java file or rename the name of the class over here. If I select the second option, this gets renamed. Okay. Similarly, if I miss out a bracket, Eclipse instantly gives you an error and you can actually introduce a bracket. Fine. So it's a smart editor. Right. So to print anything in Java, suppose I have to run the program and print, you have to write system.out.println. Suppose I write Selenium over here. To run the code, you just click on the run icon on the top and you will end up running the code. Many of you might be knowing this. Okay? So just be patient and I'll move on from simple things to complex things. Right? So I executed this code. This code can be executed by clicking on this icon, the run icon on the top, and this will execute. Or you can right click on your file and say run as Java application. This will also get executed. Fine. Now in our out here in the hard disk, right, on the hard drive, you will see the source folder, and inside source folder there is a Java file. Fine. if you go one step up, you will find the bin folder, okay? And in this bin folder, you will have this sample underscore java dot class. This is the class file corresponding to the Java file. Every Java file gets compiled into a class file, okay? And this class file, if you try to open this up, and if you try to open it in a notepad, you will not be able to understand the contents of this file. This is like a executable file. You can deploy this file on any operating system and run this. The Java is a platform independent language. That's why we use it with Selenium, because many times we have to run the scripts on Unix based servers or Linux based servers. That's why we use it. You develop the script on Windows and deploy it on Unix, it will work. This is not possible with many other programming languages. This is the one of the primary reasons that Java is used with Selenium. Okay, now as I told you, every Java file is converted to a class file. For example, I make another class file called as testapp.java. Fine. In this I write system.out.println hello. System.out.println is the command to print something in Java. The shortcut to type this is, you type syso, then hit control plus space. Okay, you write syso and hit control space bar, this will come up. Okay, if I run this code, it will print hello. And if you look at your bin in Eclipse, you will see that the test app dot class has come up in the bin. Fine. Now every Java file will be converted to a class file. Okay. If I am making 1000 Java files, all the Java files will be converted to class files. What if I have to give my client these class files? My client says that fine, give me all the class files. How will I give them? Well, I will simply think that fine, okay, just use WinZip or WinRAR, zip these files and send it across to him. Okay, in Java we don't zip the files, we actually use a jar file. We put all the class files in a jar file and give it to the client. Yeah, Ankit, you have raised a hand. I guess you raised the hand. Okay. If you have any questions, you can feel free to ask me. You can move your mouse on the top. There's a chat icon. There will be a bar coming in that. There will be a chat icon. You can send me a message. Or you can go to the participants tab. You can mute or unmute yourself and ask a question. Okay, I know you will be having a lot of questions, but I'm also going systematically over here. Feel free to ask me on Skype or this WebEx, whatever you feel comfortable with. Okay, now what I was telling you was, every Java file is converted to the class file. Okay, and Ankit, I'll answer your question, right? And what we do is that when we have to deliver the client these class files, we put them in a jar file and we deliver it. JAR, jar file. Okay. Question being asked is, how do we understand JavaDoc? To understand JavaDoc, first you have to understand Java and you need to understand the concepts of object-oriented programming. That's what I'm going to teach right now. Just hold on for 5 minutes, you'll start understanding the JavaDocs as well. Fine. Now, If you look at this JRE system library, this is actually Java which is installed in your system. This is nothing but collection of various jar files. These jar files, they come up in your system when you install Java. And under each of the jar files, you will find that there are many class files. Okay. So Java is nothing but set of jar files having many class files. These class files are made by the person who made Java. Okay. Now I'm teaching you how to download Selenium and configure it in your system. Right. This is my first motive. The thing is, Selenium guys also made Java files. They made the class files and they converted those class files into jar files. That is, Selenium guys made lot of class files and put all those class files in various jar files and they gave it to us. Fine. All you need to do is that to download Selenium,
you need to go to the site seleniumhq.org and click on the download link here, and you click on the Java link out here, Java download link over here. When you click on this, Selenium libraries will be downloaded on your machine. This is how you configure Selenium on your machine. I'm teaching you how to configure Selenium onto machine. Many people, they tell me, how do I install Selenium? There is nothing known as installing Selenium. You don't install Selenium, you configure it. There is no exe file for Selenium. You just have to download the Selenium Java version, and I have downloaded it in my C drive. This is the version, Selenium 2.24.1. Okay. In this, you have got two jar files. These are the two jar files which they have given, and also under the lib folder, you have got many other jar files. These are the jar files. Each jar file has got many classes, class files inside it. All you need to do is that you need to import them into Eclipse. How do you import them? You just go to your project properties. Right, you right click on your project, go to properties. Now this is how you configure them in Eclipse. Okay, you go to your project properties, go to Java build path section on the top. Right, go to library section. I am recording this session, you will be getting the recorded video. Right, so don't worry, you will be getting that. And go to the library section and click on add external jars. When you click on this, you will get window like this, and you can select these two jar files along with it in the lib. Don't forget to add the jar files in the lib section. Right, many people, they just add these two and then Selenium never works. Okay, also add the jar files under the lib section. Click on OK, and in your project you will get reference library section on the left side, which will have the jar file of Selenium. That's it. Okay, that's it. So reference libraries contain the jar files of Selenium, and Selenium is configured with your project. Now you are ready to use Selenium. But to use Selenium, you need to understand the concepts of object-oriented programming in Java language. So that's what I'm going to teach you now, because I don't want to directly jump over to Selenium. I've told you how to work with Selenium. Now let's talk about OOPS, object oriented programming. The complete documentation of Selenium over here. This is the download link and this is the documentation. This complete documentation is object oriented programming. A layman cannot understand this. Right? So what we'll do is we will create a new file over here, and let me call that file, say, a very generic name like city.java. So this is the file city.java. It's got no main function, nothing inside it. Okay, this is the file city.java with no main function. And what are the properties of a city? For example, it has a property like string name, the name of the city. Okay, so this is a single file with a property like name. And if you go to, if I create a new class called as, say, testCity.java with the main function. So this is the testCity.java file and this is city file. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use the city file inside testCity.java. Okay, I'll create the object of the file city. I'll write city c equals to new city. Okay, this is how you create the object. Or you just write over here like this, new city. Many times you must have seen this. I'll write this three times. Using this command, you actually create the object of the city class. Now, what do you mean by creating the object? Basically, you mean that in out here you will get three objects found in the memory. Each object would have a variable name inside it, because city has a property name.
okay, but these objects cannot be accessible. The objects can be accessed with the help of object reference. You have to write like this: city C1 equals to new city, city C2 equals to new city, and city C3 equals to new city. So what happens is that out here C1, C2 and C3, they actually point towards the three objects. Okay, now this is the object reference and this is the object. C1 is not the object. Many people think that C1 is the object, C2 is the object out here, C3 is the object. It's not like that. Okay, these are object references. Now, if I write C1 dot, you will get some default properties. So you will get the properties associated with this object. And one of them is name. Name comes from city class. Okay? I can write C1 dot name in say city A, C2 dot name, C3 dot name, A, B and C. So what happens is that with the help of object reference, I am able to give the city names. That is, this is A, this is B and this is C. So basically there is just one class having one variable. I am able to duplicate it in the memory with the help of objects. I can create as many objects are also known as instances. I can create as many instances as I want. Like I can also write C4 over here and define the property of C4. Right. Now if I write over here system.out.println C1.name, C2.name and C3.name. If you run this, this will print A, B and C. Fine. So far so good. Everybody is able to understand, I guess. Right. But something happens like this. If I write C1 equals to C3. Okay. Now what happens is that in the memory, what will happen is C1 will be removed from here. Okay. And it will point towards the same object where C3 is pointing. So object references, they can move from one object to another. Okay. And many experienced people also don't have these concepts clear. So this is basically what an object is, an object reference is. So if I again print C1, C2 and C3 name, C1 is pointing to the same place where C3 is pointing. C3 dot name is C, so C1 dot name will also become C and C2 will remain same as B. So if I run this now, put a big demarcation line, and if you run this, you will see that first it was ABC, now it is CBC. So basically you have this C1 and C3 which are pointing towards the same object. Now suppose if C1 changes the state of the object, if I write C1.name is equal to Z, C1 changed the name of the object, so it will change for C3 as well. So if this becomes Z, then C1.name will also become Z and C3.name will also become Z. So that's how objects they work. If I again print it, both of them will print Z. So if one object changes the state, sorry, if one reference changes the state of the object, the other reference gets the updated state. So if you run this, get them, right? So there can be objects in the memory, there can be multiple references to those objects, fine, and basically an object and a reference is different.
I can write like this, city c5 equals to null. Null means that nothing. So c5 object reference is not pointing towards any object. And if I write like this, that's it. Like if I write new city, that means an object which has got no reference. Okay. Now similarly in city, suppose there is a function, like this, public void get population. Okay. Or simply print name, suppose there is a function called print name, and in this we print that system.out.println city name is plus the name of the city. Okay, so now print name function also becomes a part of every object. This object will also have print name, this also will have print name, and this will also have print name. Right, so when C1 calls its print name, the name of C1 will be printed. When C2 calls the print name, name of C2 will be printed, just like this. Suppose if I write over here, C1 dot, you will get the option print name in it. Similarly, C2 dot and C3 dot. If you run this code, it will print city name is Z, city name is B, city name is Z. Right? So whichever reference is calling the function, the corresponding city name is printed. In the end, we just have got one city. That's it. Right? Now similar thing happens in Selenium as well. In Selenium, like I made city.java, all the Java files are already built in. You really don't have to worry to create your own files. You just have to create the objects of existing files and work with them. Okay. For example, there's a file called firefoxdriver.java. This one. All these are the Java files in Selenium. You see the size, right? The lot of them. Right? This is the class firefoxdriver.java. Okay? And all of these are the properties in, and functions in this class. We'll learn how to study this. Okay? You will understand it. Right? Now, I'll copy this. And okay, I'll take up, but I have i6, Venkat. I'll tell you how to work with i, but I cannot take up i because I have i6, it's a server operating system. Okay, I'll take up all the browsers, i, Chrome and Mozilla. First of all, I'm taking Mozilla right now. Okay, so so I'll just create a new file, new class called browsers.java. Okay. Now let's start with the Mozilla. Now there's a class called Firefox driver. Okay. In this driver you write Firefox driver class. If you write new Firefox driver, you are creating the object of this class. Where is this class present? This class is present somewhere in the libraries you have downloaded, somewhere in the Selenium libraries. Okay. Out here, the city class was directly visible to you, so you could create the object new city and all everything. Okay. This file is present somewhere in the libraries. You have to import it actually. You have to move your mouse over this error and select import org.openqa.selenium.firefox, this one, and this line will come up. You have to import this. If I run the code now, you will see that a blank Firefox will open up. Okay, a blank Firefox window will open up. Fine. Now, but I cannot do anything with that window. So I have to create a reference. I have to write Firefox driver dr1 equals to new file. So dr1 will be the reference to the Firefox driver object. And if I write over here dr1 dot, you will get so many functions which are associated with the Firefox driver. Okay. For example, I write dr1 dot get http yahoo.com. Well, when you use get function, right, it is to navigate to a certain URL, right? And you specify the URL here. Make sure that you give the protocol. If you don't give the protocol, you will get an error. Many times people get an error out here because they don't give the protocol. Okay, so if you run this, it will open up Firefox and it will take this Firefox to Yahoo website. Okay, now what about Chrome and IE? The way you work with Chrome and IE is slightly different. You have to download some binary executables. So I'll be talking about Chrome here, and I'll tell you how to also work with IE, but most of you would be having IE8 on your systems. I don't have IE8, I have IE6 on my system because this is a server operating system. Fine. So I will demonstrate on this OS that how to work with Chrome, and I'll tell you how to work with IE as well. You can just try it at your end. It's quite easy. It's the same way you work with Chrome. Well, for Chrome, you have this class known as Chrome driver. Okay, you go here and this is the class Chrome driver. You just have to write Chrome driver, driver equals to new Chrome driver. You create the object. You import this class, move your mouse over the error and you can import it. If I run this code, on almost all the machines you will get an error. And don't just be afraid of these kinds of errors. Read the errors. People, they get afraid of them. Just read them. It's very clearly mentioned. The path to driver executable must be set by the webdriver.com.driversystem property. For more information, see this URL. Okay. So this is the URL. And if I open up that this URL, this is the URL. If you read over here, these guys, what they have told is they have asked us to download a Chrome driver from here. It's a Chrome exe file which you have to download. You go to the download section and hold on. You have this Chrome downloads.txt. Visit this URL. Okay, hold on. They have changed the location. Hold on. Please visit. Okay, this is the URL. Chromium.google.com. Okay, this is the URL to download. Chromium.google.com. Yeah, this is the one. So I'll give you, hold on, they have changed the, just a minute. Go to Google and type Chrome driver Selenium. Yeah. To set up, first download the appropriate pre-built server. You need to download this. Yeah, this is the URL. I'll give this URL to everybody through WebEx chat. You need to go to this URL. Fine. And depending on your OS, you download the zip file. Right? For example, I download, mine is a Windows based system, so I'll download the latest one on uploaded on August 21st. Download this and once you have downloaded, right, you have to extract it and after extracting you see that there's a file called chromedriver.exe. Don't try to execute it, you don't need to execute it, right? I'll just keep this file in my H drive. Okay, and in my code I will write like this. You have to set a system property. You see the error message says that the path to the driver executable must be set by the webdriver.chrome.driver system property. Okay, so you write over here system.set property webdriver.chrome.driver. In the value you have to give the path of this exe file, that is, it is in my H drive, chromedriver.exe. Okay, now if you run this, Chrome will work. If you run this, this is not an error message, this is just a message from Chrome driver, and you see that a Chrome browser will open up, right? And again you can write over here driver dot get the URL. So you have to just create the objects of the internal classes and work with them. So if you again run this, this will open up Chrome and take it to Yahoo. See that Yahoo is opening on Chrome. Right. Now, if you look at this log, this is something which is generated by Chrome. Chrome actually generates a log file. It keeps the log file at this particular location. Rather, it keeps it under your project only. If you refresh your project, you will see a chromedriver.log file getting generated. You just have to right click on the project and refresh it. You will see chromedriver.log generating. This is generated out here. Okay. And this log file, you will not be able to understand much in it. It's a little bit technical. But chromedriver does that. Now, how to work on IE? I have IE6 and you have IE8. That's the problem. But for IE also, the process is same as Chrome. For IE, we have a driver known as Internet Explorer driver. This one. Okay. And this driver just have to create the object of this driver. Fine, import it, and if I write dr dot get http yahoo.com and if I run this, you will get an error. I has opened, but I get an error that again the path to driver executable must be set by this property webdriver.i.driver. So you have to set the path with this property in the same way you set the path for your Chrome. Now first of all, if you are using IE8, turn off the protected mode in IE8. For IE, first of all you have to turn off protected mode. Better to turn off, right? It should be at the same level, but I prefer turning it off in IE8. Just go to Google and type turn off protected mode in IE8. You will get steps, or IE9 as well. It will work on IE9 as well, IE8. You just follow the steps how to turn it off. You have to go into Internet Explorer options and turn it off. Okay. After that, you have to download the IEXE as well. So if I write iDriver server exe selenium, you will get the link. This is the link. Yeah, this is the one. One for 64 bit machines, other for 32 bit machines. So you download the 32 bit machine, it's a standalone server.
I'm not sure whether it will work on my PC or not because I have i6. i6 is a, everybody knows how good a browser is. i6, it's a terrible browser, right? And you extract here. You have to download i from this link. I'll give this link to everybody through Webex chat. Okay. And once you have downloaded and you have it extracted, this is the iDriver server. Again, I'll keep it in my H drive. Fine. And I will write over here H drive, the name of the exe file, that is iDriver server.exe. Similar to the thing like we did in Chrome. So you have to set the system property. And now when you run this, I'm keeping my fingers crossed. Hold on. Yeah, it is working. Okay, this is a server. This kind of window I always get on the server. Hold on. Yeah. So it is working. But in i8, it will be much smoother than this. I have the server OS, that's why. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll stop here for today. Fine. And